evening once again. It is my pleasure to be back to the Sparta after many, many years. And as a matter of fact, last time I was here on a conference on philosophy. On a totally different name. We're going to talk about aging. My background is molecular and cellular biology, which I understand some of you may not feel so familiar. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to describe the work in the more simplistic terms, but perhaps for those ones who are more familiar with molecular biology, just follow the slides. So, we talk about aging. And I have said from the very beginning that aging, it is an inevitable, but still natural process. There is no a single living organism in this planet, all the way from lower prokaryotes, bacteria, to human beings, that somehow can escape aging and death. And of course, that opens up a big discussion, why aging does occur, and why life, essentially, is bound to the aging and death. What we know, however, is that aging is accumulation of errors. Accumulation of errors in our motor molecules, namely DNA and proteins. And what actually is happening, as to the reward, and essentially I focus 90% of my lecture on human beings, essentially there is a point that all of this accumulation, all of these errors accumulate. And somehow, the biological systems cannot cope with these errors. We have damage on both DNA and proteins, but there is a big difference between the two macromolecules because, essentially, whenever the DNA is being damaged, I would say that by definition there is a DNA repair enzyme being capable of repairing the damage. For very obvious reasons, because we do not like to inherit mutated DNA into our offspring. However, proteins, which are the functional molecules, essentially the molecules that perform all the different biological activities, are also damaged. And as you see on the slide on the top, there are a number of modifications that convert a normal protein to its damaged isotope. I mean, of course, everyone doesn't have to be a biologist or a clinician knows about oxidation, but there are many, many others, and I quote a few examples. And actually, what is happening? And there is a big difference because, as we said at the bottom, there are very, very few protein repair systems. And if we're talking about mutations of amino acids, there is only one system, the so-called methyl cyclooctatase, that is able to repair methyl. So, just to get the degree of what is happening, out of the 20 amino acids we have, essentially nature has developed one enzyme or one family of enzymes to repair methyl. So, what is happening as time passes by is that essentially we have accumulation of all of these damaged proteins form protein aggregates. And there are a number of age-related diseases that relate to these aggregates. For example, beta-amyloid plaques in Alzheimer's disease, alpha-synuclein in Parkinson's disease, and many, many others. So essentially, as the biological system grows old, you have accumulation of this material. And the only way, the major way that the biological system has to remove the materials is to degrade it. To degrade it by the major synthetic cellular machinery, namely the chromosome. I assume that Mictarius is going to talk about other pathways just soon after I finish my lecture. Essentially, to form peptides, and then other enzymes, other proteases, cut the peptides from the acids. So you clearly understand from this summary slide that if you have a reasonably working proteolysis, essentially, not only we minimize the accumulation of all of these contributions to the but also have threatened masses for the normal synthesis of the proteins, a process that still requires a lot of energy. So the protozoon, it is very concerned with evolution. You can find it in this various formation from bacteria all the way to Homo sapiens. And essentially, it has very subunits. The subunits in red are the ones who carry the catalytic subunits, the catalytic activities. These activities, essentially, are able to degrade the damaged proteins. So, I will go through the data just to show you that this enzyme, which is a very essential for vitro proteolysis, does not work properly as a biological system agent. So, for example, we have taken here young and old cells, and if you see the protozoon activities, you see that in young cells, the activities of the protozoon are down-regulated by a factor of 2 to 3. So, essentially, as a biological system CNS, these are human cells, we have CNS in the lab, essentially, they exhibit reduced levels of protozoon activity. That is what you might expect. Also results in the accumulation of damaged materials, like the oxidized proteins, as well as the accumulation of proteins that have been labeled for degradation by another system, namely lipid, that apparently cannot be able to be degraded. But what we want to find out is why this enzyme has an impaired function with aging. So essentially what we need is to examine every single protozoon subunit, 28 in total. And essentially, we're able to identify that three of them, there is no need in this audience to go into the details, essentially are now regulated in late passage age cells in comparison to the levels 1 versus young cells. So, the message from this work was that as aging occurs, we have two things. We have enhanced demand of proteolysis because the system accumulates more errors, therefore, there are more damaged proteins that they need to be degraded. But in addition to that, genetically, we've seen a while how this genetically is really controlled. We have the downregulation of three subunits that are great, therefore, essentially, you have less protozoon production, less enzyme. What would happen if you take young cells and you inhibit this enzyme? You can do that because in the market there are a number of so-called protozoon inhibitors. So, if you see that in the microscopic pictures, for example, I mean, these are young fibroblasts. If you are familiar, these are typically young cells. You see that all the cells become old after several months. They have this rigorous cell. And then you see that if you take young cells and you inhibit the protozoon, essentially they acquire the pathology of the old cells. So protozoon inhibition induces premature senescence. And of course, genetically, this is genetic. I mean, for those of you who are more familiar with the aging process, you see that aging occurs by the CS of aging by B21 and maintenance of aging by another protein by the name of P16. So the message was that not only aging has an impaired function of the protozoon, but if you take young cells and you inhibit this enzyme, essentially you introduce premature aging, or as we call it, premature senescence phenotype. So that was the gray part of the story. So the question is that if you have this knowledge, whether it's possible to activate this enzyme and what will happen. This approach was essentially to repair the defective genes. We knew the defective genes, so essentially we can overexpress the genes in the cellular system, as you see on the right, and if you do that, you result in cells that may inhibit enhanced levels of protozoon and enhanced levels of protozoon activities. And importantly, this is a functional design, because if you see on the gray bars, on both top left and bottom left, these cells, where we have genetically activated protozoon, they exhibit enhanced levels of proteolysis and cell survival if we treat cells with cell toxic agents. And more importantly, if we do these experiments in normal cells, we delay aging by a factor of 15 to 20%. So protozoon activation by genetic means results in increased proteolytic capacity of the cells that we do the experiments and delay of aging by a factor of about 15 to 20%. Obviously, we wanted to identify why this situation occurs, so we start looking for transcription factors that perhaps they may regulate the protozoome subunits. So one of them, a candidate one, is, has an NLF2, and you see that NLF2 is down-regulated as cells on the right, and even NLF2 target gene, like NGO1, is also down-regulated in senescent cells in comparison to the levels we observe in other cells. In accordance with these experiments, it could knock out this transcription factor by a silencing, by a siRNA, essentially would not lose senescence. And then by having this information in mind, we start screening for compounds by using biobanks of compounds as putative activation of this pathway. So one compound has the name of geriatric acid, and as you see that if you take this compound, it activates the transcription factor at the RNA and the protein, the transcription factor as it should, it translocates to the nucleus, and it has more activity. And importantly, this activation is also activated the protein. Because, for example, if, for example, we either use it in conditions where the transcription factor is mutated or has been silenced, we deactivate it. So here we have a condition that we have identified natural compounds that essentially activate protosome via the transcription factor. And this activation is specific because essentially if the transcription factor is not functional, then there is no activation. Importantly, if you take one of these compounds and you treat cells continuously, you do react exactly as it happens in the genetic situation. And even if you take all cells that receive activity in the enzyme goes down and pass the M1, and then you treat them with the compound, you restore about 50% of some activity. So the message was that you have identified two compounds that essentially activate the protosome via a known transcription factor, and if you do that, essentially you increase the proteolysis, but also you delay aging. So that turned out to a patent and to a set of products being commercialized by Greek companies in Johnson & Johnson Pasteur. But if I go to the scientific part of this work, that work essentially demonstrates that we have a transcription factor that is inert in a cytoplasm by another factor by the name of KIPS. Essentially, we introduce one so-called inducer, and the inducer breaks the complex. The transcription factor translocates to the nucleus. It is a so-called leucine zebra transcription factor, so it makes complex with small mass and drives the so-called adaptation response element, being present in several genes, including the proteasome subunits. So you have massive production of proteasome subunits. And if you have more proteasome subunits, you have more proteasome. And if you have more proteasome, you have all of these beneficial effects that relate directly or indirectly to the retardation of the aging phenotype. So that was the work we did with natural compounds. Obviously, natural compounds have big advantages because essentially we pay attention to what we call Mediterranean diet, so they're essentially part of our daily nutrition, and they have, by definition, less side effects. However, in a recent project in NHRF, we start taking this information that just came from pharmaceutical compounds and compounds that essentially we construct ourselves in collaboration with the pharmacists in NHRF. And of course, that essentially it is a more risky project because you never know where you find a compound with a high specificity, but then if you do, of course, you have a new drug. And this is, of course, very important. So, all of this was essentially in vitro studies that we did by using human cells of Bulgarian galactic. Let's see some vivo data. Obviously, we can take genetics in human individuals, or we can take biopsies. And when I say biopsies, it is either skin biopsies, skin fibroblasts, or it's simply blood or blood monocytes. So, as we see here, the older you are, the rarities, the lower the function of the protosome. But when we took biopsies from health centenarians, you see that health centenarians have more functional protosome in comparison to the other donors. So again, that was an observation. There is not much we can do in humans. What we can do in modern systems, and here comes our collaboration with Nectario, that is going to talk so much when I finish. He is one of the leading scientists in the famous war, a model essentially introduced by Sidney Brenner, I believe, Nectario's in the 70s in Cambridge. It has a number of advantages. Those were a few minutes, and I'm sure that Nectario will speak about the elements much better than I would do. But essentially, we sent people to create the learning technology, the transfer of the technology, somehow to act, because I'm always in human, so just kidding, the question, so I'm not going to be. So you see that if we genetically activate the protosome by this essentially that results to increase levels of protozoa. Importantly, the world that now they are genetically activated for the protozoa live much longer, as we see here. And the beauty of the elephants is that you can do genetics and you can start using the pathways. So the most important pathway is the so-called NGF pathway. And you're saying that protozoa activation does require the N transcription factor, that's 16, because if you mutate at 16, which is the Fox orphan in humans, essentially you lose the effects, but it does not require the receptor, that too, because you can see the leads or mutate the receptor, which will have the effect. So clearly it's DAF6 independent, but DAF2 independent. And of course, we screen for other pathways, like the Hitchcock factor 1, and STING 1 is also phenomenon 2. So again, the data in human cells essentially fit very well in the model system. So the message here, just not to talk too much about that, is it seems to be the protozoa activation is a concerned mechanism of delayed aging throughout the period of evolution, because even other groups are working on the system, so they find the same results. So it seems conservative. Okay, this is obvious, and I mean, in conditions that protozoa is activated, essentially it grows much better than when we treat it to cytotoxic agents. But the other beauty that you can do with cells is to cross the protozoa activation strains with strains that represent models of diseases. So, for example, you can take conditions that warns that there are models for this kind of disease. Why? Because they accumulate beta amyloid plaques, and you see that in these conditions, when protozoa is activated, there is less accumulation. And here I have to be careful. I would not like to say that protozoa activation could be used therapeutically against Alzheimer's, but clearly it minimizes the accumulation of beta amyloid plaques, and whether the beta amyloid is related to Alzheimer's or not, this is another big issue that we will not touch on. And importantly, you can achieve that not only by genetic means, but also by the delivery of compound. So again, you see that if you take this compound, it inadvertently passes, and you treat, and you give it in the food of the form, you have exactly the same effect, essentially, massive elimination of beta amyloids in the world. So I will spend a few more minutes on molecular biology, and then I will go to more familiar areas for most of you. Also to say that protozoa appears to have an important role in stem cells, because stem cells MS, as every other metabolic cells, so if you take stem cells, as a human stem cells, or whatever, or working jelly, essentially to see that after single passages, the cells will stop dividing, and then they lose their differentiation capacity. That is combined with decreased levels of protozoa, exactly as we have in our systems. And exactly as we did, essentially, if we activate the protozoa by genetic means, we increase the lifespan of stem cells, and more importantly, we increase the reproductive capacity. So this seems to us as a new mechanism, perhaps we may increase stemness, and then we have that's how this situation occurs. Because apparently we're able to do the fact that some of these differentiation factors like OX4, they bind to the promoter environment of protozoan genes. So let me now move for the next to something more general. And this is some big projects we did just to study factors related with aging and genetics in human beings. So I'm going to refer to two or three again. Big networks that we have participated over the years. One of them is the genetics of healthy aging in Europe, and here we want to identify longevity factors. 10, 15 years ago, we used to work on health centenarians, individuals that have exceeded 100 years of life, obviously being the record holders among the human beings. But talking about longevity with people like you, by mathematicians, I told them that instead of working on health centenarians, perhaps it's better to look for long-lived families. So in this biobank, in 12 European countries, the idea was to identify families having two or more brothers and sisters, siblings, alive over the age of 90. Why? Because if in Europe you reach 90 years of age, you belong to the 25% of the longest lived population in Europe. And obviously, if two or more family members belong to this 25%, then the possibility of this to be just random, it's very, very slim. So this is what we did 12 European countries, and to have some genetic ingenuity, we decided to just identify Caucasians, while the study also supported a recruitment in China, because at a later stage we were to compare the putative ingenuity genes of the Caucasians with the Chinese putative ingenuity genes. So, as you see on the bottom, we have identified families of 4 families with 5 brothers and sisters, all alive, all over the age of 90. Not in Southern Europe, but in Northern Europe, in the Nordic countries. But you see again, those of you who are more familiar than me in mathematics and statistics, you realize that the power of biobank, even if you take into account the family with 3, 4, and 5 siblings, more of the family sounds is great, isn't it? So essentially, this is a very strong mathematically speaking biobank. As controls, we use the spouses of the children. In other words, people who most likely share the same environment, but see genetically speaking, they are totally different to the people who essentially do not provide. So essentially, this work identifies 4 chromosomal designs that relate to longevity, and when the process identify the genes for one of them, of course, we know that is the ApoE design that essentially encodes one allele that has been linked to longevity in a number of studies. And of course, we found a lot of genetic variations. For example, you see that changes and the problem of DNA mutations in different Nordic countries, like that one in Sweden. But apart from the genetic analysis, there were other data that we collected from the biobanks, and I will go through just a few examples. So, for example, you see that this healthy long-lived siblings, they have very low cholesterol levels, even lower. If you ask them whether they're having exercise, most of them say yes, because they are just people who work in farms, so they're still active in having some kind of physical activities. Very low smoking. You see that 68% of them never smoke, and another 22% have quit smoking for at least 10 years, so essentially 90% of them are not smokers either for life or for the last 10 years. Then, in this very subjective question, how do you feel? You see that 2/3 is not very good. So, these are clear, very optimistic. And talking about recruitment in Greece, and actually, since we are in Greece, I have to tell you that the longevity zones are essentially villages in the mountains of Peloponnese, in the mountains of Crete, and then a few islands like Icaria, that essentially came out of this study, and a few other islands in Aegean. And people were very optimistic, very positive about that. And they don't suffer from all this pessimism that you see that compromise a lot of people in later days. And importantly, spouses, just to reach the conclusion, right? Spouses of the long-lived siblings, although they have shared the same environment for the long-lived siblings for perhaps 70 years, they are not long-lived, thereby demonstrating that the genetic component is important. So you need the genetic, the right genetic background with the right environment. If you don't have the right genetic background, then the environment, perhaps on its own, doesn't play a role. So you need a combination. And this is some of the hypothesis, but of course this remains to be tested. Then I will move to another biobank. So here we don't care about longevity, but we do care about longevity. So here again, where we started with the recruiting women, we asked for normal people, adult people from 35 to 74 years of age. Here we don't care about genetic ingenuity, but we care about lifestyle. So the inclusion criteria were that some person who enrolled in the study, they had to spend at least half of his life, her life, to the country that now he or she is. So for example, a person who was born in India but moved in UK when he was 10, and now he's 45, we assume that he has adopted the British lifestyle, so he drinks beer instead of lassi, and she's not vegetarian, and so on. So this is the standard biobank. Then we have the offspring from the families of the long-lived siblings, and as controls are the spouses, so to see whether there's any inheritance, let's say, in this longevity phenotype that we may involve, and a few some from progeroid symptoms, like cocaine, vermiculite, similar that essentially result in premature age. And to all of these people, we have studied 46 different biomarkers. And you see that this set includes a bit of everything from clinical markers that typical GP will test his patients to clinical care and the more specific markers of genetic drivers. Out of that, we came with a patent of the best scorers. Perhaps all of these letters mean anything to you, but wherever you see CPG means methylation. And when we talk about methylation, we talk about epigenetics. And if you're not familiar with the term, epigenetic is how environment influences our genetic material. So this is perhaps the emerging hypothesis that you need the right genetic material that you have in the environment, that perhaps via methylation or other pathways still to be identified, essentially switch on or switch off the right set of genes and of course the right set of protein. So these are the female scores. If you look at the menu, you see some common genes. But sure, it's different, of course. So, where are we going from there? And this is where I'm going to stop. I mean, this is nice, so obviously, you can do self-correlation, just increase knowledge, which is very important. I mean, you can do that because we like to ask, who am I, and why do I live? And we see it's essentially a philosophical question. But still, we need some practical approach. I mean, how can we apply that on daily practice? So some that we have initiated quite recently in Athens in collaboration with a number of private engaging units would essentially to enroll people, volunteers, patients, and people who are interested in. These people, they give some blood. We start a few biomarkers, very, very few because it's very expensive and then you need an amount of blood that essentially it's not possible to do a proper analysis, so we restrain ourselves to 20 milliliters of blood and about 5 biomarkers. Of course, just to remind you that telomeres are putative biological blood, so one has to study telomeres as well as biomarkers. So a patient gets a score. And that is important because it doesn't mean that every cell and every biomarker is going to do the same score. So if you are 50 years old, it doesn't mean that every cell of yours and every molecule within your cell is going to show 50. So you get a variation. And this is okay, but what is more important is that we pass information to the clinician. Now we know that there are ways that we can essentially manipulate a given biomarker. For example, the protozoan, we have compounds that essentially we know that can activate the protozoan. So essentially, the volunteer, the person who scored, should follow the advice of the doctor in collaboration with us and should change his life. The point is that what is needed and what a lot of people do is a re-evaluation after 3 months. So essentially, it is not that important knowing that although you are 50, your cells look like being 45 or 55. What is more important is to know that although you are 50, you live in a way, your lifestyle essentially accelerates or decelerates the biological clock in favor or against essentially the time as we measure to convention. And this is important. Obviously, here the idea will be just to include more treatments, which essentially may manipulate more biomarkers and include more biomarkers. So these are the very few steps, and at least there are a few centers in Athens that are willing to collaborate with that. But this is something that has to be advanced. And just to give you an example, I mean, this is how the biological clock is shortened over time, but if you score here, essentially it means that although you are 45, your telomeres are likely to be, you to be 30, and this is and we have this example. I just did a free example. You see here on the top, we have a person who is 81, but with very low kilograms, but it's going to doesn't work. That results in accumulation of oxidized proteins. While here we have two examples with very good rotation, very low amount of oxidized proteins, and of course the block works much better. So this is essentially just a flavor to what we observe and what we plan to do. And I'll stop here by thanking my colleagues and I refer to the European Union Lab because there was some collaborative problems and take questions. Thank you. Denmark, and you go to the instead of the interior, and you get the legs of the central nervous. So it's just like the brain with the gentle. Here we have to go through from Nika and the organization of centers that provide pensions. And of course, that started before the crisis. And I can easily say that a lot of people will just imagine we're seeing grown people without real people being there.
I'm seeing that your first work was in
we started with the government as well as...
It was pioneering.
Yes.
Because
nobody was talking. And of course, it's very difficult because in this biobank with a lot of signals, you have to convince the person that is not easy. And then you have to convince his brother and his sister because you have to have the entire family. I mean, one person in the family will not be. So it was really an effort just to find this people. And that's why we stress having minimally the hundred account. And in Greece we found about 100 in the stocks because it's very easy. And also to practice, because it means that if you go to Greece, for example, and you have to go to the village in the mountains, and then you have to go to Iraq with a sample, that's what I said. I don't know whether you can try something else, but it is not easy to have to manipulate something. So that requires some infrastructure that no country, regretfully, it doesn't provide it.
I have another question. I'm not sure, correct me if I'm not right. You said what you didn't say. Can you, made an invention with supplements or food
yes.
Or diet?
There is. I prefer to study isolated compounds. I mean, this is a big story that we can start now. I mean, when you have a supplement, usually it's an extract. An extract by definition is something that's not defined, and you cannot really repeat. So, for example, you have extract from the olive tree. I mean, when this is something that contains everything. And we work with that, the way we do it is that if you have an effect on an extract, then you ask the pharmacist to do a step-by-step explanation. Identified the active compound. And this is the scientific way. Companies do not want the scientific way, because if you have a cream with an expert, then the definition is just gray science. So you can claim whatever you like, because the next may complement that. So there is a conflict between what scientists want
and
what business people they do. So you have to go with the compound, because then you have the compound. Ideally, if you have the compound, and then you find yourself the structure, the rest of the structure, to make your own compound, but perhaps so, if food supplements do not contain extracts, but they contain compounds, then of course, you can do that. But essentially, the work with it was simply on isolated compounds. We have a project on nutrition, a European project, but time is not for me to go through. There, we have studied how given food interferes the but actually, I was not involved in doing these experiments in Greek people because I thought that it's very difficult to put Greek people on a very steep diet than to a person that for 3 months you are going to have to eat only carbohydrates and nothing else. I mean, I would say that by default, this is for the Germans and Nordic people, not for us as volunteers to participate. So we have data, but the data comes from Greece.
Thank you.
All right.
Question? Yes.
Excellent work and excellent presentation. I enjoyed it very much. I would like to ask you, did you see, for example, in Italia, any family with two centenarians as husband and wife, two of them 90, 95 years old, and did you do any check, any testing of the DNA of their offspring? And what did you find? A double amount of
DNA? I will give you my answer as a politician. In Korea, there were very few individuals, something like 36 total. Therefore, you cannot do any proper statistics. And of course, it was difficult in the sense to do the proper analysis. However, whenever you have an area where you have at least 10 times more long live than the average population, that is considered to be a blue zone. And actually, we're going to have a paper, at least submitted, about blue zones. So, the biggest study has done something wrong. Because ideally, you need, first of all, you need an island. Assume that in the island you have some. Yeah, exactly. You have a certain degree, so the genetic information, let's say, has stayed more in an island. So, Greece in total does not qualify for that because Greece, there's not a single place which has been without influence from introduction. I mean, this is my impression. So it's very hard to find a place. I mean, that's why you have to go perhaps to villages in the mountains. But then if you go to villages in the mountains, you have very few people. So it is impossible. So that's why people started in Sardinia, because Sardinia is big, it's the size of Greek population wise. And then there they have 10 times more centenarians. And funny enough, they also have something very peculiar, which I didn't mention. In Sardinia, the ratio of male to female centenarians is 1-to-1. While in Europe is 1-to-6. And just to give some other data, I mean, I meant this presentation European, not Greek. In Greece, we find a ratio of 1-to-2.9. So we have twice as many male long-lived people in comparison to what we call Europe. And just to give you the flavor, if you see the data in Italy, southern Italy is exactly like this, 1-to-2.9. Central Italy, Rome, is 1-to-3, 1-to-4. Northern Italy, Milan, Torino, etc., is 1-to-6, 1-to-7. So in the same country, if you go from north to south, there is an increase of the number of male living leaders. So why that is happening, we don't know. And it could be a genetic factor that somehow has been reserved to the Mediterranean area, or could be even social factors. Because you have to imagine that a typical woman in Crete or in Sicily had a totally different lifestyle than the same person living in Sweden. Okay, because she was a farmer, she had to give birth to 10 children and she was doing too many things. While people in North Europe were industrialized, they were entering into a totally different style. So, yes, there are some data, but essentially, and for sure we know that if you have a long lived person in your family, it is more likely to be the early person. So, there is some component, but the way is essentially, we need many more data and we have to put everything together. And this is what you have to do, just to read it by mathematicians to see what fits with what, and then the data have to go back to us and do the biological and genetical analysis. This is my belief.
Yes,
thank
you
very much for your talk. Coming from the computer science field, I'm going to start with the games of your work. I fully understand the fact that last week of the meeting, so my question is how do you quantify that? And also in our lifetime, also how much do you sleep, when do you sleep, how much steps do you sleep every day, and also the type of the blood pressure.
Of course, you can measure it. So, I mean, first of all, nowadays, don't tend to increase less than the same. You tend to increase slightly less. So the aim is, and it should be, not to increase the life expectancy, which already is too high, but to increase healthy people with their goals. So if you can make an individual old person living like 60, then it's a big achievement. And this is one kind of quantification. Then we have a number of markers. And of course, the ideal figures for blood pressure for the activity of the system is very fair. So essentially, you can score that. Lifestyle per se represents the main role. We know from studying the homopsychotic clinics that the way you have thought and if you look to live your life, it is then a factor. A factor is two, combined with the same environment. So it is very important. And then the question is that, can we score your own lifestyle against your biological clock? This is what important. So it is not just to put you as a total statistics, it's important for you to be Mr. Of course, you need the statistics, of course, you need the data, but then you have to take the analysis just to recruit out of the pool of the analysis and treat the person with the data. But this is rather complicated, not so complex, and so that before they are not one group that could produce very expensive drugs. And for instance, you have what we call massive production drugs. So it's another problem there.
I want to put another view of that of an epidemiologist, because I'm an epidemiologist. There are a lot of tools we use to measure exposure. That's what we put the question, how you measure exposure to an environmental factor. And another point is what's the reflection? How we can standardize the reflection. There are a lot of questionnaires, standardized questionnaires, that can give us the lifestyle and the quality of life. And these could be useful to you and to everyone. Standardized questionnaires, I can give you that.
Yes, I mean, we have them. Essentially, all of these European networks and perhaps standardized questionnaires. How to say rules? Exactly.
What is the question?
Oh, it's everything. I mean, you can even measure the time you need to sit in the front and stand up. And then there's a score. You can take it, you can do a muscle. But another thing is to have to be a score. I mean, if you want to send me an email, I'll send you a question.
But this is a large time because this is actually an indication. That means I want to be active, I want to
make a goal. Yeah, again, there are guidelines. I mean, people who are training, they say to you 5 hours per week of training, for example. But yes,
what
about
that? The limitation comes to the interpretation. To interpret the answers, you must take into consideration to the person who of the responder, the origin of the responder, and this is the difficulty, and that is the bias sometimes.